For many Christians, the most significant question regarding creation and evolution is this: what about human origins and Adam and Eve? The theological questions around the age of the earth or plant and animal evolution are one thing, but the theological questions around human origins are far more complex. When I started studying this question over 20 years ago, I quickly realized that I wasn't going to discover an easy answer. In fact, Deb and I don't completely agree with each other on this issue, and that's okay. There is an underlying harmony, even if we don't fully see it yet. Our first step on this issue is to learn about various Christian models for bringing together God's Word and God's world. We found it's helpful to discuss five major scenarios which Christians propose regarding Adam and Eve. As we go through these five scenarios, we'll speak to the scientific and theological complications facing each view. While none of these views are without challenge, each of them seeks to uphold the authority of Scripture and God's sovereignty over nature. The first scenario is Adam and Eve as recent ancestors. This interprets Scripture as saying that Adam and Eve were specially created by God, not descended from animal ancestors, about 8,000 years ago, and all humans are descended from them. Adam and Eve fell into sin in a single act of disobedience to God. However, scientific study of God's world over the last few centuries poses serious challenges to this interpretation. In addition to the evidence for great age from geology and astronomy, paleontologists have dated the first human fossils to around 150,000 years ago in Africa. That's roughly 140,000 years earlier than the timeline proposed in this view. Scientists believe that, from its roots in Africa, the human population spread out into Europe and Asia, then to Australia and the Pacific Islands, and reached the Americas around 15,000 years ago. Archaeologists have found human fossils all over the world dating back to 15,000 years and longer. In addition, this interpretation faces some long-standing biblical and theological questions. For example, Genesis 4 and following chapters seem to imply Adam's family interacting with other humans. Think of Cain's wife and those cities that were built so quickly, raising the question of who these other humans were or whether the population could have grown so quickly from just two individuals. In addition, the Genesis account features a talking snake and two miraculous trees, clues that many biblical scholars say were always intended to point to a symbolic rather than a literal interpretation of the text.
Because of these difficulties, some Christians turn to a second scenario: Adam and Eve as ancient ancestors. In this view, God specially created the first pair, Adam and Eve, but 150,000 years ago in Africa. This view faces the same biblical issues as the first model and adds a new one. The Bible speaks of the first humans as Middle Eastern farmers, not as African hunter-gatherers. Scientifically, this model does much better, especially with the archaeological and fossil evidence for early humans. However, it still faces some serious scientific issues. Scientists have known for over a century that human anatomy is similar to chimpanzees and other apes. Evolution predicts that if humans share a common ancestor with these animals, there should be fossils going back in time that look less and less like modern humans or modern chimpanzees, and more like the common ancestor of both humans and chimps. This prediction has been confirmed. In the last few decades, scientists have found hundreds of hominid fossils that trace this pattern of development, pointing to a common ancestor about 7 million years ago. A second line of scientific evidence comes from the genetic similarity between humans and animals, which also strongly points to a common ancestor. Human genes are most similar to chimpanzee genes, less similar to orangutans, and even less similar to other mammals. A third line of evidence is also genetic, the genetic diversity within the human population. Human DNA simply contains more variety than could arise from a single ancestral pair. The minimum bottleneck of the human population must have been thousands of individuals, not two. When I first learned about this one, I was stunned. I just didn't see how this could fit with the Bible. But there are ways to do this, and we have three more models to show you.
The first of these is our third model, Adam and Eve as a group of ancient ancestors. In this view, God used evolution to create human beings, leading eventually to a population of a few thousand Homo sapiens in Africa about 150,000 years ago. This view is fully consistent with the scientific evidence. It also resolves the biblical issue of Adam's family interacting with other humans in Genesis 4 and other chapters. However, it doesn't resolve the biblical issue of the cultural setting of Genesis being Middle Eastern farmer rather than African hunter-gatherer. And it raises a new biblical issue. In this scenario, the earliest human population is several thousand individuals, not a single pair. And that's not so easy to resolve with Paul's reference to one man, Adam, in Romans chapter 5. A possible solution is to propose that Adam and Eve were leaders within a larger group, or are biblical symbols representing a larger group of real people. In this kind of scenario, where God uses evolution to create humanity, some new theological questions are raised. For example, what does it mean to be created in the image of God? Theologians have discussed this concept for centuries. Some say that being created in God's image refers to our mental abilities greatly exceeding those of animals. Others point to our relationship to God as persons. Other theologians say it refers to our commission to represent God's rule here on earth. And perhaps it's all three. Other theological questions arise around the question of original sin. We could suppose that in this population of humans living 150,000 years ago, God revealed his will to them for how they ought to behave, and they rebelled. But this raises a new question. Just how intelligent and morally advanced were they when they began sinning? And did thousands of individuals sin all at once, or did it start with a few and then spread? And how did sin spread from some individuals to others?
These sorts of questions lead some Christians to favor a fourth scenario, Adam and Eve as recent representatives. In this view, God created the human species about 150,000 years ago in Africa, but Adam and Eve lived 10,000 years ago in the Middle East, along with a lot of other humans. From among those, God specially chose Adam and Eve and revealed himself to them, but they rebelled and fell into sin. This model is consistent with all the scientific evidence. Biblically, it resolves some issues. It returns Adam and Eve to the cultural context described in Genesis. It also resolves the issue of who Adam's family was interacting with in Genesis 4. However, it introduces a new biblical issue. In this model, Adam and Eve would represent all humans in the first sin, but not be the ancestors of all humans. Maybe Genesis 1 is referring to the creation of the whole human population, and Genesis 2 and 3 are referring to the more recent pair. It would mean that the genealogies in Genesis are referring only to Adam's family, not to the whole human population. Theologically, this view struggles with the issue of original sin. If Adam and Eve were the first to sin only 10,000 years ago, what about all those people living before Adam and Eve? Were they leading sinless lives? And how did sin spread around to the whole human population living around the world at the time of Adam and Eve? Another theological issue is the death and suffering of humans in those years before Adam and Eve, since the Bible teaches that death is the consequence of sin. It could be that the curse in Genesis 2 and 3 is referring to spiritual death rather than physical death.
Because of these questions, some biblical scholars look at Genesis 2 and 3 in their cultural context and propose a fifth scenario, Adam and Eve as symbolic. In this view, Genesis doesn't refer to a particular individual as an historical Adam or a single event. Rather, the story of Genesis 2 and 3 is symbolic of many acts of rebellion against God by our ancestors over a long history. This model is fully consistent with the science, and it resolves a number of biblical issues, including the symbolism in Genesis 2 and 3 and the additional people implied in Genesis 4. In fact, proponents of this model say that this is closer to the original intent of God's message for us in Genesis 2 and 3. However, it raises a new biblical question, that no single pair or group speaks to the literal Adam that Paul seems to describe in Romans chapter 5. One possible solution is that Paul was speaking in his own cultural context, which assumed Adam not only as historical, but also as an archetype for all humanity. The main theological issue raised by this scenario, where Adam and Eve are symbolic figures, is that we couldn't point to a single time in history when our ancestors were as intellectually and as socially advanced as we are, and yet also sinless. In this scenario, as our ancestors gained in intelligence and moral awareness, sinful disobedience to God's will would have grown right alongside them.
Well, we've given you a lot of information to think about and 5 different scenarios to ponder. We've pointed out that each of these scenarios faces some difficult questions. It takes time to think through these issues, both individually and as a church, and Christians will need to continue the discussion. This is an issue where that underlying unity between God's 2 stories in nature and in Scripture is not immediately clear. But we can take hope. That harmony can and will be found. We can remember that God is the author of both His Word and His world, so science cannot rob us of our faith. In fact, all 5 of these scenarios accept the authority of God's Word in Scripture, even while they disagree about how to interpret it. And all 5 of these scenarios accept that God is the creator and sustainer of the universe, even while they disagree about how to weigh the scientific evidence. And they all agree that God has created humans in His image and invites us into special relationship with Him. And even though they disagree on how that first sin happened, they do agree that all people have sinned and need a Savior. Jesus Christ died to restore our relationship with Him. While the scientific exploration of God's world can raise some difficult questions, it can also reinforce our sense of wonder and awe at God's power and creativity. It can even help us understand God's love. Psalm 103 says, "He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us." This vast universe with its high heavens is not meant to teach us how small and insignificant we are or how distant and absent God is. It's meant to teach us about how vast God's love is. He removes our sins beyond the ends of the universe. The ruler of the galaxies decided to come as a tiny baby. How much more approachable could God get? God came to share our sufferings and to bear our sins and redeem us to Himself. He did not cling to the heights of heaven. He came to live among us. So the good news, the best news, is that our Creator is also our Redeemer.